Good morning, everyone. Great to have you here. We're going to get started, so come on down and grab a seat. It certainly is wonderful to be back in person. So thanks to all of our vendors and our host today. My name is Eric Roges. I'm on staff here at Rolling Hills as the executive pastor. And we want to welcome you. It's our honor and privilege to host Breakfast with the Mayors. And great, again, to be back in person and online as well. So as you're coming forward, would you join me in a word of prayer for our morning today? Let's pray. Our great Heavenly Father, we are so honored and privileged to live in a community like this. We consider it just a joy to be able to serve in this community. And we ask this morning that you bring just wisdom and clarity and discernment to the leaders of our community, to the mayors and others, other elected officials. Help all of us to be great citizens, to understand the freedoms that we have here in this community and in this country, and namely the freedom of religion, the freedom of faith. And so we thank you for the privilege of gathering together today. We thank you for the opportunity to hear from some incredible speakers today and learn a lot about what's happening right here in our community. And again, thank you for the privilege it is to be here, to be in this community, and we ask all of this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning, Patrick.
Good morning.
How are y'all? Everybody, come on.
Good morning, everybody. Come on up.
Come on up. Get close. As close as you're comfortable. It's all good. It's all good. It's really great. It's hard once you haven't been with people that often to want to come back and sit down because you want to talk and see everybody. I did too, you know. We could just have a breakfast with the mayors.
Just
like
breakfast.
A receiving line, maybe, and everybody just shake hands, something like that. I don't know. I'm just trying to come up with something. But I hope y'all will come and sit down. What a great morning. Seeing a lot of faces we haven't seen in a long time.
A lot of faces. I'm glad we're back in the routine of doing breakfast with the mayors here in person. And please tell all your friends. We do this once a quarter. Check our website out. FranklinTomorrow.org and get all of our events.
So
I see you have an I voted sticker on, Mindy.
Yes, I voted yesterday in the May 3rd primaries that are coming up next week. I'll be out of town, so I voted early, and it was so convenient. I voted at the Downs Boulevard County Election Commission site.
Wait a second. I thought you voted at the county complex.
No, Patrick. You don't vote at the county complex anymore. You vote on Downs Boulevard or one of the many other convenient election centers.
I think I'm going to vote early at the rec center on Hillsborough Road.
On so. Hillsborough Road, but all of the rec centers in our county serve as early voting locations, and you can vote at the facility on Downs Boulevard. But early voting ends this Thursday.
I saw Chad here, Chad Gray at the Election Commission. So,
and while we are an apolitical organization, I can say that there are a number of people whose names are on those May 3rd ballots or the ones in August. If you're a candidate, please stand, wave your hand.
Here we are.
Thank you for putting yourself out to be a member of public service, and we appreciate that. And you can introduce yourself to individuals and learn more about these people who are here today.
Very good. Want to thank, you know, we couldn't do what we do at Franklin Tomorrow without our partners. And Breakfast with the Mayors is presented by Pinnacle Financial Partners.
And I saw Vicki Manning here this morning and Linda Elmlinger. So thank you to Pinnacle Financial Partners.
What a long time partner, and we really appreciate what they do for Franklin Tomorrow. Also, a sustaining partner, which you'll hear more from today, is Williamson Medical Center. And Mindy, I had an experience with Williamson Medical Center the last few weeks, and just how, and really, again, was reinforced how fortunate we are to have such a high-class community healthcare center hospital in our community. But had to take a child to the children's ER, and to have the level of staff, the care, the high-touch environment. It made me think and thankful to be in a community with a place like Williamson Medical.
And it was Dad taking the child on his own. But Dad had a great experience there.
Thank you, Williamson Medical, for all you do for the community.
Thank you. And then our platinum partners for 2021 are Patterson Hardy and Ballantyne Certified Public Accountants, Williamson Memorial Funeral Home, Hazen and Sawyer, Gresham Smith, and the Williams County Association of Realtors. And as always, we appreciate the Good Food Group, our local McDonald's franchisee, and Puckett's Grocery and Restaurant for providing breakfast. So thank everybody. Thank you so much. Now, where in the world is Rogers Anderson? I don't know. Rogers, are you here? I don't see Rogers. Diane? Maybe you're going to sub in. Okay, he's at a hospital conference in D.C. Did I know that? No, but it's okay.
That's all right. It's all thematic today.
Great. So there's a couple of special dates that we'll tell you about at the end of the program, but there's a couple of special dates this week, including today is Alderman Matt Brown's birthday, and tomorrow is Alderman Patrick Baggett's birthday. Happy birthday to both of them. So thanks.
Let's have a party.
Except y'all can't come to it together.
We can't have a party.
You can't. Well, you want to sing?
If Matt comes up,
come up here, Matt.
You can sing happy birthday.
So it'll be Matt and Patrick when we get to that part, okay? So, yay. So, happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Pat and Patrick. Happy birthday to you. Great. Thank you so much, guys. Thank you so much. Thanks so much. And we will get started with the program. And I'll just bring up the only mayor we have here today, I think. And that'll be Franklin Mayor Ken Moore. Come on up, Ken. So,
where do you want me?
You can take the whole stage.
Wow. Well, good morning, everybody. And this is exciting this morning. You know, being a physician, it's always good to talk about health care and understand what's going on. I think I'd like to sit down.
Okay, just move that mic out.
But maybe I should show my scar from Williamson Medical on my knee. But I'm not going to do that. I appreciate the opportunity to maybe just make some brief comments about the city of Franklin's healthcare journey, where we focused on the health of our community, and thanks for our great partnership with Franklin tomorrow. But whenever Governor Haslam challenged a number of cities across the state to be a healthier community, we responded and identified four areas we would concentrate on, which were obesity, tobacco cessation, activity, and mental health. And I think subsequently we were named one of the healthier cities in Tennessee, one of nine cities that got that designation. We were excited about that. But what we found is that it was very challenging to get anybody to talk about the mental health aspect. Nobody minded talking about being fat, not getting exercise, and shouldn't smoke. Those were easy. But to get people to have that conversation about mental health, it was difficult. So I guess just before the pandemic, we had a Blue Ribbon panel come together, and a lot of representation from many organizations, many of which are mental health professionals, came together, and we identified in our community that we needed to raise awareness and have that discussion about mental health, particularly since in our community we've seen an uptick in suicide in the past few years, particularly with middle-aged men. So we embarked, along with Franklin Tamara and other organizations, the Refuge Center, Mercy Clinic, our health department, to try to educate our community and on suicide and mental health. So let me stop right there and then ask everybody a question. How many of you know CPR? Way to go. Good. All right. How many know QPR? Disappointing. Why wouldn't you know question, persuade, refer, suicide prevention? So I challenge every single one of you to learn about how to prevent suicide. What are those signs that you need to be looking for in your family or your friends? And how do you ask those questions and how do you refer them? So thank you to Vanderbilt for a grant that helped us train 9 trainers who can go in and train groups. It's about an hour and 15 minute long session for you to understand how to ask those questions, how to recognize those symptoms, and where to send that person. So you can also look at our website, Find Hope Franklin, and understand that. So that would be my challenge for you today as we try to become a healthier community. Certainly the conversation about mental health is going on now, particularly with professional athletes and other high-profile people coming forward and talking about it. So if you or your group want trained, just talk to Mindy. So I'm excited to have Phil and Williamson Medical Center this morning. I'm excited that Kathy Montgomery's here. During the pandemic, we've worked very closely with Kathy and the hospital. And also, we've worked very closely with Kathy as far as this Blue Ribbon panel. But Phil, I've got a request for you. It always scares me when somebody says, would you do? But since we're kind of getting back together, I thought it might be very, very appropriate this morning to recognize our healthcare workers. You know, they've been through hell the last 2 years. You know, they're stressed, they're overworked. And so I would ask every one of us to give a loud round of applause and ask Phil to take that back to his staff, how much we appreciate them.
You've got a date coming up in May, don't you?
Ooh, I've got a great date coming up. May the 11th, we have the State of the City, and in the title this year is Better Together. The other thing that I need to do that I wrote down in my notes was I've got a special guest this morning.
You do?
She's a very attractive lady. She's a little bossy sometimes. Happens to be my wife. Linda is with us this morning. Where are you, Linda?
Where are you? Oh, there she is.
Oh, here she is. Yeah, love of my life and my inspiration and also the person that gives me my instructions. And, of course, we have a few other aldermen here this morning. I saw Alderman Peterson and I saw Alderman Hansen and welcomed them. And if I missed any of the other aldermen besides Alderman Brown and Alderman Baggett, please raise your hand so I can recognize you and see you. So, anyway, so we got a long day, so thanks for having me this morning. I look forward to the conversation.
I think it's going to be interesting. And as it relates to QPR, Franklin Amaro coordinates the offering those QPR classes, and we can work with your group or organization to provide trainers for that free of charge for the QPR class. And then we'll be offering some additional QPR public classes in May, which is National Mental Health Month, and in May, on May 9th, our next Frank Talks lecture series will be at West Haven Residence Center. We've got a great panel of mental health experts. We'll be talking about the current status of the ability to find and receive treatment or care here in Williamson County. It'll be a great program, but we've got a lot going on in May as it relates to Mental Health Month. So, but as the mayor said, we Franklin Amaro has been involved in the health and well-being of our community for a number of years. Since in 2011, we did a revisioning, and we discovered that none of our goals and strategies related to the health and well-being of our community. We came together with a group, and that's how our Get Fit Franklin program was initiated. But we have worked with Kathy Montgomery, from the director of the Williams County Health Department, for a number of years, and are proud to serve on the Williams County Health Council. And I'm going to bring Kathy up to talk about the Williams County Community Health Needs Assessment that's been done. Big green button.
This is better stuff than Rogers, isn't it?
Big. Yeah, it's better. Well, oh no, okay. You're subbing for Rogers, by the way.
Oh, I am. Good morning, everyone. It's certainly a pleasure to be here and to see your beautiful, unmasked faces this morning. I appreciate all the partnerships and so forth that we've had with Williamson Medical Center and others, and I do want to extend, if I can just briefly, a big thank you to our health department staff and our employees there. I want to tell you, these last 2 years, they have worked tirelessly with National Guard, with our local paramedics, with contract nurses, and numerous volunteers to perform almost 68,000 PCR tests for our community, and we are nearing our 100,000th COVID vaccine that we're about to give. So it's pretty phenomenal. So they do amazing work to keep our community healthy. So I want to go on to talk a little bit about our community health needs assessment. And so when we think about what impacts the health of our community, really only about 20% of our health is impacted by health care. And while quality health care is certainly really critical to the health of our community, we also have to look at the healthy behaviors that we exhibit, as well as conditions that surround us, for example, our physical environment, social factors, for example, housing, education, income, those also have a greater impact on our health. So we have been blessed the last about every 3 years. We work with Vanderbilt University Medical Center, the health department does, to conduct a community health needs assessment. And this is really for us to gather data together to look at the health of our county. This year, we had the privilege of also partnering with Ascension St. Thomas to assist us in this endeavor. So what the hospitals did is they pulled together lots of information, lots of data. They did an environmental scan of different county level reports. They looked at things from Tennessee aging and disabilities. They looked at American Cancer Society reports and numerous others. They also conducted key informant interviews of our county leaders, of local residents. They conducted community surveys to ask individuals and our residents, what do they feel like are our health issues in our community, and what do you think we could do to address these issues? And then finally, we looked at secondary data, which is things like infant mortality rates and looking at leading causes of death and things like that. What they did then is they pulled all this data together, and then we developed or collaborated or coordinated a subcommittee made up of different businesses, organizations. Williamson Medical Center participated on that subcommittee so that we could look at all the data and do an extensive review of it to identify some priorities for our county. And these are the identified priorities that we selected out of numerous things that that surfaced to the top of health issues in our community. But the four things that we decided that we were going to try to address over the next 3 years were mental health, affordable housing, healthy living and prevention, and substance abuse or misuse. So some of the information that came out of our discussion around mental health, and certainly that fell out from the interviews and so forth, were the ratio of providers that we have in Williamson County compared to our growing population in our community. Also, some of the discussions came out around the affordability of behavioral health counseling and mental health counseling. A lot of insurance plans don't cover the cost of behavioral health, and so this became a cost burden too if people have to pay out of pocket for counseling services. In addition, like the mayor mentioned, suicide deaths were also something that surfaced to the top under mental health. I can tell you that we've been tracking suicide numbers since about 2013. And on average, Williamson County averages between about 30 and 32 deaths per year due to suicide. Like the mayor said, also that most of these occur among middle-aged white males. And I can tell you, I can't say with statistical significance, but I can tell you that since we've started the task force and started raising awareness about suicide prevention, that in 2021, Williamson County's deaths dropped to 24. So that is really an improvement. While one suicide death is too many, we did actually see an actual decline. I will say on a side note that a lot of people usually predict that our suicide deaths occur during the holiday seasons and so forth. But in Williamson County, it's interesting to us that most of our suicide deaths occur, based on the data, in the months of June, July, and October. So it gives us some information for when we want to maybe predictably put out information and raise awareness during those times. Affordable housing was another priority that we wanted to address. When we look at the cost burden associated with mortgages, and certainly this data was only through 2019, we haven't received more current data, but predictably we could probably determine that there will be an increase, obviously, in the housing costs for Williamson County residents. But when we look at the cost burden that's associated with that, with both mortgage and rent, it's a burden that impacts some of our really critical resources here in the county. For example, our teachers, our healthcare workers, and our first responders. There's also a lot of prevalence with impacts on our senior community as well, with burdens of housing costs. Then we look at healthy living and prevention, and while obesity is only one metric that we actually looked at, there were several others that we looked at as well, because obesity is linked to poor diet, physical inactivity, and numerous chronic conditions. So we looked at that and also wanted to look at ways that we could maybe improve those healthy behaviors that impact the health of our community. Also included in this were a lot of discussions around the built environment and preservation of those green spaces as we start to see construction increase in our different cities and towns. And then the last thing that we wanted to address as well was substance misuse. And while we're really kind of focused on our youth, we're a little focused as well on our adults, because unfortunately, according to the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation and United Healthcare, our binge drinking rates in Williamson County are far exceed what the rates are in the state. So we want to address that, but also thinking about our substance misuse among our youth. So when you look at the information, this is a survey that's put out every couple of years with our high school students, and the average age of initiation for tobacco, alcohol, and drug use is the age of 14. We have an anti-drug coalition in Williamson County that already has a substance misuse plan that we're looking at, as well as the opioid epidemic and so forth. So we're adopting their plan into our community health improvement plan, which kind of leads us to our next steps. So while we've identified all these priorities, Now it's time to start coming up with the strategies to address these. And so we are working with our local health council and with other agencies to look at developing goals for a community health improvement plan that will be from 2023 to 2025. We're trying to work with stakeholders or identify stakeholders in the community, and also to look at how we can evaluate the outcomes of our strategies that we implement. So I encourage you that if you're interested in any of these priority areas, to please reach out to myself or to Mindy, and we would gladly love to have you work with us on some work groups to work on those plans and those strategies. So I appreciate your time today, and thank you.
Kathy and her staff do a great job, but it really is the coalition working together that has put together the community health needs assessment, and then we'll now work on that improvement plan. So excited about that. So as we mentioned, Williamson Medical Center is a great part of our community, and we, if you've ever been a patient there, whether it was at the old hospital or the new facility, guess what? There's going to be even more of a newer facility. And so I want to welcome to the stage Phil Mazuka, the CEO of Williamson Medical Center, to tell us about the future of Williamson Medical Center and its impact on healthcare in our community. Let him have that mic.
Good morning, everybody, and thank you for having me here today to talk about a really exciting time for our hospital and our community. I've lived here this time for the last 14 years, and before that, I've been in healthcare for the last 40 years, and all my healthcare experience has been in for-profit healthcare up until Williamson Medical Center. So I've been around the country. I've taken care of about 200 hospitals across the country in many states, and I can tell you that this is one of the most amazing hospitals I've ever been associated with. So I'm going to tell you a little bit about what's going on with Williamson Medical Center. But to start, I wanted to tell you a little bit of history, because when I came to the hospital, I didn't know a lot about the hospital. So I had to figure out, where were we, and where are we, and where should we be going? And just to give you a brief history lesson on the hospital, in 1954, a local physician decided that Williamson County needed its own hospital. And so Dr. J.O. Walker went to the state legislature and requested us to be granted a private act hospital district for Williamson County. And in 1958, the hospital opened with 50 beds. And there were two existing hospitals in the market at that time. It was Dan German Hospital and Pyle Hospital. And those two hospitals closed the day that Williamson Medical Center opened. And on the day it opened, the hospital sent out brochures to the community. And one of the things that was really impressive in that brochure is it said that the hospital was dedicated to the benefit of humanity. That's a pretty big statement about what the founders of Williamson County Hospital at the time had decided what they were doing for this community. And we'll talk a little bit more about that and what it means today. But from 1958 to 1986, the hospital expanded three times over that 20-year period and went from 50 beds to 188 beds. In 1986, when there was a decision made to move the hospital to its current location, the hospital opened with 144 beds. Now, from 86 to 2003, there wasn't a lot that was taking place at the hospital, but in 2003, the hospital added two new floors to the main tower, an MOB, and the parking garage, and at that time was up to 185 beds. So in 2003, we're about the same bed size that we were in 1986 when we closed the original hospital. And then in 2015, we opened the Monroe Carroll Jr. Children's Hospital Vanderbilt at Williamson Medical Center, and in 2019, the Bone and Joint. So realistically, over the years since 1986, there hasn't been a lot that had been invested into the hospital in its current infrastructure, and we're going to talk a little bit about that as we go on. excuse me, this is my allergy season, so I'm in my wheelhouse right now. So I think when I first came to the hospital, I had to really understand what we represented. What were we here for? And I was really impressed by the mission, vision, and value statement, and I've highlighted some of that for you to see. So our mission is really simple. We exist to meet the healthcare needs of the community we serve. We don't exist for shareholders. We don't exist for corporations. We don't exist for other sister hospitals. We exist for one reason and one reason alone, and that's to meet the healthcare needs of our community. If you look in our vision statement, we want to be the preferred provider of healthcare services to the residents of Williamson County and the acute care center of excellence for our surrounding region. So these are things I start to think about when I came to the hospital 13 months ago as far as why are we here? And I highlighted one of our values because this is really important too, in that we want to create customer value through our commitment to deliver clinical quality, so we want to have high quality customer service, we want to have a great customer satisfaction, and cost efficiency to be a low cost provider. So when I start thinking about the mission, vision, and values, I said, okay, where are we and where do we need to go? So if you really look at our commitment to quality to start, we are an extremely high quality facility. We are only one of three hospitals in the state of Tennessee that received the Centers for Medicare and Medicaid Services five-star hospital quality rating. We're only one of 455 in the country. And the way that CMS determines their star rating is on two things: quality metrics and customer satisfaction. I came from a company of 90 hospitals. We might have had three hospitals in the entire company that were five-star hospitals. It's amazing that this community has a five-star facility. You know, we really have to start to think about what we really mean to this community. So we are an economic engine in the community, and we support business and residential growth. I know that businesses, a lot of times when they're looking at areas, what do they look for? They look for good school systems, they look for good health care. And so it's really important as we see growth in this community that we provide great health care services. Another thing that's important is we're here 24/7, 365 for this community. If people didn't believe how important we were to this community, over the last 2 years, I think they realized that. When we had the pandemic hit, we were here. We were one of the few hospitals, I believe, in the country that didn't go on diversion during the pandemic. We took care of every patient that came to our door. There were times when ICU beds in the entire region were full and patients came to our hospital. We put those patients in medical surgical beds and took care of them with critical care staff. We didn't go on diversion. That was extremely important. And we'll talk a little bit about a life we saved later in the process. We treated, so far, somewhere over 5,900 COVID positive patients. We treated about, I think, almost 2,030 COVID positive inpatients over the last 2 years. We did 45,000 COVID tests over the last 2 years. This hospital is so important to this community, and it's such an asset. So then I started thinking about, okay, where are we going? And the focus has to be elevating our service line capabilities, elevating our quality, elevating everything we do from a patient care standpoint, including patient satisfaction, patient safety, and those things that you may take for granted. I think another important point about this hospital is because we don't have to worry about shareholders, because we don't have to worry about corporations, because we don't have to worry about sister hospitals, we can invest back into our community. One of the things that we do that's really important is that we provide the EMS 911 service for Williamson County. It costs us $5 million a year more than we take in for the service. So we're investing into the community that $5 million. And here's what's special. We're only one of seven EMS services in the country that's approved to administer blood on the scene. That's amazing. We've saved lives at scenes because we're able to administer blood. We know that those people would not be here today if we couldn't do that. We're only one of seven in the country in Williamson County. We're opening more and more EMS stations. I think we have 17 stations right now. We opened one in Brentwood recently. I think we're opening one in Nolensville this coming year. And so we're continuing to put our EMS locations closer to residents of our community. You can see here on this list all the other things that we invest into this community. Whether we're at providing trainers to our high school football games, whether we are supporting nurse practitioner and physician in our health departments, you can see the amount of uncompensated care and charity care we do every year. We invest back into our community. So I'm going to give you a little bit about stats because this is sort of what blew me away. So today we're licensed for 203-bed hospitals. I've run hospitals that are as small as 25 beds to as large as 900 beds. So a 200-bed hospital to me is a smaller hospital. But what was interesting to me is we take care of over 159,000 patients a year. We do 9,000 inpatient admissions a year. We do about 15,000 surgeries a year. We treat 50,000 people in our two ERs. We have an adult ER and a pediatric ER. But what's really amazing to me is this last point. We have 825 providers on our staff covering 70 specialties and subspecialties. In my career, I've never seen a thing like it. A 200-bed hospital throughout my 40 years is a staff of about 100. It doesn't have a large breadth of specialties that it covers. What we have here is amazing. The DNA of this hospital is incredible. I couldn't believe what I was seeing when I saw this. And then to meet the physicians. We have physicians from Vanderbilt. We have physicians from Ascension St. Thomas. We have the top providers that I've ever been associated with at Williamson Medical Center. I don't know that many people realize that. Another thing we have to think about is the growth in this area. So I think about where we're at as this 203-bed hospital with this great DNA, what's happening in our community. We've all seen these numbers before. The growth is incredible. We're at 250,000 residents in Williamson County today. By 2040, we're projected to be 500,000. That growth is unbelievable. There's one thing in here I've got to laugh about. If you look at the last point, our expected five-year growth rate for 65 years and older is over 5% a year. And I laugh about it because my wife and I are going to be one of those statistics in the next 5 years. So I've got to worry about having a place to take care of me too. So I'm going to talk to you about the project. After really thinking about what we mean, why we exist, where we are, and where we're going, we spent a lot of time doing an analysis on what is it we have to do next. So I'm going to talk to you about our project that we have, that we've broken ground on less than a month ago. When you look at this picture, you'll see the tan area is our existing facility, and the darker brown area is what we're talking about from the expansion project. You'll see the red line on that west tower. That west tower is where our current pediatric area is, and that tower is three stories high. So the red line, what you see above that to the north of it, doesn't exist today. So we're basically taking the west tower and going from three floors to six floors, But that north wing is going to be a six-story north, new north wing. You'll see the bottom part where it shows the ED expansion. That's where our emergency department is expanding, and it's about going to double in size. So what this picture just shows you, this picture shows you in the orange area, that's our existing ER. The blue area is the expansion. I just wanted to show you the size itself of the expansion is about two times the size of the existing ER. One of the things we learned in COVID was how important it was to have social distancing. One of the features of this expansion is going to be a very much expanded waiting room for our adult ER. We're going to have additional isolation rooms and those things. But there's a couple other things I wanted to talk about. And I know the mayor brought this issue up of behavioral health. Over the years, I've seen across the country this increase in incidence of behavioral health patients coming to acute care hospital ERs. Behavioral health doesn't have a lot of access, easy access to care, and so they come to hospital emergency rooms. In our current emergency room today, we take care of the patients, but it's not in a safe and secure area. They're within the main ER in patient beds. And when I thought about this, I said, we've got to do something so that we can have a safer, more secure environment for behavioral health patients coming to our ER. And so one of the things we're doing is we're putting in an 8-bed secure pod in our ER. And so you'll see that here. And so we'll have locked doors, be able to keep patients safer, we'll be able to keep staff safer, and we'll be able to keep everybody secure. And so this was a really important issue for us to make sure that we can handle this increase in behavioral health. And then, as I said, we're expanding our main lobby, adding isolation rooms, and we're taking our total number of beds from 28 to 43. Really looking toward the future of where we need to go. Most times, you won't have to wait today for an ER bed, but there are peak times when our ER is full. We have 28 beds, we may have 35 patients requiring a bed. So this is really an important part of our project to expand our ED. And this is what an artist rendering of what it's gonna look like. It's gonna be beautiful. We're doing a lot of cardiology at our hospital. Our cardiologists, all of our cardiologists are Vanderbilt cardiologists and Ascension cardiologists, and they're really talented. And as we continue to grow in cardiology, we just thought that we needed a separate area for cardiology in this new West Tower. And so what this expansion does is it takes two cath labs and puts them in this cardiac center and a new electrophysiology lab. And electrophysiology is when you do pacemakers and implantable cardiac defibrillators and those kind of things. We currently do those in the ER today, but we're bringing in new technology, so we're gonna have an EP lab in this new construction and then 7 beds for pre and post procedure. In our OB area, what you see on your right-hand side is our existing facility. And that's where OB exists today. The left side is the West Tower. Right now, that West Tower on that floor is just shell space. And so we're basically taking that shell space and putting our postpartum beds in that West Tower. We're expanding the LDRPs. We're adding a C-section room. And if you see that pinkish area that's toward the bottom of the screen in the main tower, we move our NICU from a sort of ward in that sort of red middle area down to its own secure wing. And the NICU will have private bays. It's state of the art. It's going to be beautiful. We're taking our NICU from 8 beds to 9 beds. So this shows you the third floor of the West Tower on the left exists today. That's where our pediatric facility is. If you see that north wing expansion on top, we're putting 22 observation beds there. So many times patients come to the hospital, they're having a heart issue, they don't meet admission criteria, but we really need to watch them. And so right now, those patients are being put on the med-surg units. What we're doing here is we're putting a 22-bed observation unit into that new north wing of the third floor. On the fourth floor, today we have two ICUs. Both of them are 10 beds in our existing facility on separate floors. What we're doing here is we're taking our ICUs to 35 beds. We know during the pandemic, this whole area was lacking ICU beds. So we're going from 20 to 35 and putting them on the same floor in this new fourth floor of the West Tower. And what's really important here too is all the public areas in the West Tower will be outside of the unit, elevators, waiting areas, and those types of things. On the inside of the unit, more secure, we'll have elevators for staff and patients, and we'll have that secure access in and out of the unit. I think this is an important slide because in 1986, design was different than it is today. You can see on the left side our current ICU room. That these sizes are comparable to each other, so the left side will show you how much smaller it is than the new room. And one of the things that really has troubled me about design from the 80s or previous design is that toilet that's under the cabinet in an ICU that swings out when you want to use the restroom. And I always thought to myself, if I end up in an ICU, I am not going to use that camper toilet. And so what we designed here is something you probably won't see anywhere else. We've taken the ICU and we've put a full bathroom with a walk-in shower, toilet, and sink. And you can see in there we've also added a couch area so that if patient families want to stay with the patient, they can. And we made this much more comfortable. We've added a sink just for the docs and the staff and visitors and a place where you can use your iPad. But the difference in the size of the rooms is incredible, but this is what our new ICU room is going to look like. I'm sure you've never walked into an ICU that looked like that. On the fifth and sixth floors, we're going to put 36 medical surgical beds on each floor. Same concept, waiting rooms on the waiting area on the outside, public elevators on the outside. Everything patient care happens on the inside. Same thing as with the ICU. You can see the current room size versus the new med-surg room size. In our current rooms, we have the toilet and the shower in the bathroom, and we have a sink on the outside that's used by patient, staff, visitors. When my wife was a patient at the hospital, and she's had three surgeries in the last 2 years there, when she was a patient at the hospital, before I ever became CEO, she had knee surgery, and when they brought in the portable x-ray, I had to move the bedside table out of the room so they can fit the portable x-ray in the room. In 1986, we weren't bringing technology to the patient, we were taking patients to the technology. So these rooms are small. When she got up to take her IV to go to the bathroom, she came up to the bathroom and there was a threshold that she had to go over and she couldn't lift the IV pole over the threshold. I said to myself, this is crazy. What if I wasn't here to help you? You'd have to call a nurse or you'd have to struggle with it. In this new room, there will be no thresholds. The shower, the toilet, the sink for the patient is inside that closed room. You'll be able to wheel equipment into the room without having to move things. You can see that light blue line, that light blue sort of semicircle around the bed. That's basically area that's supposed to be clear so you can move equipment around. It doesn't exist in the current room. It does in these new rooms. And again, this looks just like that ICU room, just some less gases and things on the wall, but it's going to be very comfortable. So our project overview is our West Tower project is phase one and the ER. So West Tower, ER, OB is phase one. And when we're done with that, we're going to have 156 licensed beds in that tower. In phase two, we go back into the main facility after we move everyone into the new tower, and we renovate that tower. So we're taking 3 patient rooms and renovating them down to 2 patient rooms so they can be equally as nice and as big in size. So if you really think about it, our total license beds goes from 203 to 270, but the observation beds are unlicensed, and the 17 labor delivery recovery beds are unlicensed. So if you really compare apples to apples, we're going from 203 beds to 309 beds. You've probably seen these numbers before. Our total project cost is $200 million. We're able to work with our county commission to get support for $150 million of bond financing. We've asked our foundation to raise $25 million. We have $8 million on hand from prior bond financing for the OB unit, and then we'll use $17 million cash on hand. And I want to make something clear to everybody today. We don't get taxed funding. We don't get tax dollars. The county helps us with EMS, but other than that, we are a standalone governmental entity. I think a lot of people think that, you know, we get county funding, we get tax funding. We don't get that. And so everything we do, we have to generate the income ourselves, borrow it. And so being standalone, it's a little bit tougher for us to do these kind of projects. We're excited about this project and what it means to this community. Our groundbreaking was April 4th. And our phase one of our project will be done in 24 months. So April of 2024, we'll be able to move into the West Tower, the ER will be completed, as well as our OB unit. Phase two, going back into the main facility, that'll take 16 months for the renovation. So I just wanted to share with you a quick video on our groundbreaking celebration that happened on April 4th. It was an amazing event for us. So let me just share that with you. What a beautiful and exciting day for us to celebrate the beginning of a transformational time for our hospital and for healthcare in our community. Our mission is simple. We exist to meet the healthcare needs of the communities we serve. We don't exist for stockholders. We don't exist for any other reason than for the community and the healthcare that we can provide.
Our county is going to see sustained growth for decades to come. And we took that growth into account as we worked with architects and other planners to refine our vision. Now we stand here today on the verge of breaking ground on the largest renovation and expansion project in our history.
If we continue to deliver on our mission, vision, and values based on the DNA we have here, it was really important to me that the physical plant and the technology matched that DNA. And in order for us to continue to take care of our community, we wanted to make sure our patients and our community can stay here for their healthcare services close to home.
As I looked at that building, my last memory was being whisked through that building to a ICU room where I spent a considerable amount of time battling COVID-19. 2 years later, I am still here. And if it was not for Williamson Medical Center, I can definitely tell you the outcome would have been different.
Not only is this our home, but this is our community and this is our hometown hospital. And just knowing that it's expanding is so exciting. So I'm so happy to be a part of this. And also, I am so excited to announce that the Darrell Waltrip Automotive Group has just signed on to be our first official corporate sponsor. So thank you. Yes.
This is our home forever. We're just happy to be associated with it and watch it grow with the community. I mean, there's no way you can watch the people coming here and not make this place even more amazing than it is.
We are also hopeful and expectant that this entire wonderful community will stand beside us and go forward with us in this campaign. Because truthfully, together, More For You Close to Home can be a tremendous success.
So one of the things that I asked our architects to do, I thought to myself, as this community continues to grow, as we continue to meet the needs, the healthcare needs of the community, where could we go? What's possible? And so our architects came up with a plan that showed me on our current campus, you can see those yellow sort of areas. Those are new towers that we could add to the hospital. You can see some outbuildings. We can have a cardiac center, whatever it may be. But this tells me that I can go from 309 beds to 716 beds on the same campus. So this hospital, the sky's the limit. And with what we have as far as our medical staff and our employees, we can get there. So I want to give you a quick update on COVID-19. I gave you some stats already. I can tell you today, I'm not sure I wasn't at the hospital yet, but we've been having 0 to 1 patient in the hospital for the last several weeks. So very favorable. I also wanted to update you on the Monroe Carroll Jr. Children's Hospital Vanderbilt. You probably read in the paper a year ago that we had an agreement with Vanderbilt that we were going to cancel. We have not canceled that agreement, and as a matter of fact, we've been working hard with the Vanderbilt team to really improve the delivery of care at Williamson for pediatric care. And we're working with Vanderbilt to bring more pediatric subspecialists to the market. Vanderbilt will take a bigger role in the Children's Center as we move forward. So our partnership is not gonna go away, it's gonna get stronger, and we're gonna be able to keep more kids here in our community. So I'm really excited about that. Here's the last video I'm gonna show you. So over the last 2 years, as the mayor talked about, hospital teams have been stretched to the limit. Most hospitals lost a lot of people to early retirement. Some people just decided to get out of healthcare because it was traumatic. And so most hospitals are working with less staff than optimum right now. And they're tired, but they're there. They're resilient. And so we ask ourselves why we do what we do. We ask ourselves, why do we exist? And I'm going to show you this video about a patient that was with us for almost 2 months.
What I would like to do is just take this time and give back to you the love that you gave to me. I try to explain to my friends and family, you know, I don't care how much you watch Grey's Anatomy, ER, whatever medical show you're into, it does not do any justice to what you guys do. You guys have one hell of a job. Hang in there. You matter. If it were not for God using you guys to take care of me, I wouldn't be here today. You're my hero. And I thank you from the bottom of my heart, for my family, my children, and for life.
So I'm going to finish with saying I'm proud to be a part of this hospital. I'm proud to be a part of this community, and I hope you all are too. Thank you.
You want to just have a seat? So I too could give testimonial after testimonial about my care I've received through Williamson Medical Center staff, and it's a wonderful facility for our community. So we look forward to continuing this partnership and this conversation. We have a lot coming up in the next few months with Franklin Tomorrow, and including our save the date right now for our 22 anniversary party. Franklin Tomorrow was founded in 2000 by a group of business and community leaders to make sure what was special in our community then would still remain for future generations. So we're going to celebrate our 20th anniversary. Okay, 2 years late, I know, but it's 22 and 22, and that'll be Saturday, July 30th at the factory. It's going to be a great party and a great thing. We are hoping to be able to announce that night, so please mark your calendars, and we'll get you more information about that. Other things to know, we've got our dip jar over there, and if you use the dip jar today, you get a special hat, a Franklinite hat. But also, who's time to renew their license plate? If you don't want to get the blue plate, which is kind of ugly, just in my opinion, you can get this very attractive historic Franklin license plate. Franklin's the only city in the state of Tennessee to have its own license plate, and you can pick that up at the county clerk's office or order it online. And then please follow us on social media, but again, mark your calendars for May 9th for the next Frank Talks, and we'll be back here in July for our next Breakfast with the Mayors. Thank you so much, and go out and make it a great day, and don't forget to vote early or on Election Day on May 3rd.